I call this meeting to order. This is a special meeting of the Taos County Board of Commissioners. Thank you all for being here today. It's August 30th, slightly after 11 a.m. Again, our apologies. So we had a very good meeting this morning, and hopefully we'll continue on. Clerk, call the roll.
Chairman Farrow?
Present.
Vice Chair Gallegos?
Will be with us.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner Blankenhorn?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Present.
Okay, if we would all please stand. Mr. Neal, would you lead us in the pledge?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I have an implied motion and second to approve the agenda as presented. Discussion? Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Commissioner Blankenhorn?
Yes.
Vice Chair Gallegos?
Yes.
Chairman Farrow?
Yes. Item 5 is a public hearing. This is a discussion, consideration, and decision regarding the approval of a public hearing for a major development permit, commercial use for 3,888 solar panels on 7.7 acres of a 58-plus acre tract. Minimum height would be 7 foot 6 inches. Proposal will also include a 350-foot by 4 foot to 6 foot by 6 foot concrete equipment pads and the construction of a chain link fence, 3-strand barbed wire fence 8 feet high. The proposal further includes construction of a 16-foot access road from Valencia Road to the proposed site. The purpose project is located at number 16 Alondra Court off County Road B042, also known as Valencia Road, in the lower Deswantes area, Taos County. This will be presented by Mr. Edward Veal, our planning director. Thank you, Mr. Veal.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, commissioners, Mr. Corbett, Ms. Rocktail.
If I can interrupt, at some point here, since we've been here all morning, we are going to have to break for lunch at some point. We'll kind of see how we start here, and we'll try to figure out where we're going from there. But just let you know that a lunch break is a possibility. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, commissioners, and staff members of the public. Mr. Chairman, commissioners, I would simply just like to take a moment to advise all individuals that we do have a sign-in sheet if anybody desires or wishes to speak or address you during the public hearing. Mr. Chairman, commissioners, I came before you approximately a month ago to request this date for this public hearing and this time. At that time, we indicated to you that if it was your discretion to perform a site inspection, that we would become available with your transportation available to you to perform a site inspection. Before we move forward with the public hearing, is it still your desire to move forward with the site inspection?
Pleasure of the commission.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to do a site visit. I'm not familiar with this area.
Okay. Obviously, Vice Chair Gallegos cannot. He's in ops.
Excuse me, Mr. Chair. I'm sorry.
No, I was just saying that you would not be able to do a site visit with us because you're in ops.
No, not today. I apologize for that.
That's all right. So Commissioner Romero is requesting a site visit that could be conducted with you and Commissioner Romero?
Mr. Chairman, yes. And it would certainly be available to all commission members as well.
Okay. And what time are we proposing this to occur? Would you ready to do that? Well, I'll let you take it.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It would be very appropriate for you to sit beside if you choose to do so before the public hearing. This way you would get an understanding of the location in relation to the properties in the area and in relation to single-family structures in the area as well.
Mr. Occhio, do you have any information you care to share with us on this?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, and the interested parties in this hearing, the key for commission in this site visits is just to assess the scene. They will not be using that information to render their decision. However, their decision will be based upon the testimony and evidence presented at the hearing. But it does help commission to orient themselves to what's being spoken of with more than just seeing a map. So I would just keep caution commission to remember to not discuss this site with anyone, and that your decision is based not on your observations but upon the evidence and testimony from the hearing.
Mr. Chairman, just clarification, discussion with anyone, but what about the staff?
The as always, staff may discuss with you. The only time that that's a problem is if it's an application of the county. But otherwise, then you may ask questions of the staff about the application and the case pending before you, and ask for orientation of the site and what where the proposed location of this matter before you today is.
Anything else, Commissioner? Well, based on Mr. Vigil's recommendation and any commissioner that wishes to attend, I think that it would be appropriate to do the site visit now and reconvene. I'm thinking, because I know the construction, the town started repaving today, so I don't know how bad the traffic is, so I think we need to allow adequate time. I don't want to make the public wait again, so I would say that we would reconvene at 1 o'clock.
Mr. Chair.
Vice Chair Gallo.
Just real quick, for this question is for Mr. Gill. I guess all surrounding and neighboring property owners have all gotten the letters, we've done all the proper protocol to get that information out. So I wouldn't want this visit for anybody to vote to if we haven't everybody's been informed. This is the question I have for Mr.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, is staff's determination that the applicant has complied with the notification requirements? The notification requirements for a major development permit require that the applicant, by first class mail, notify property owners within 1,000 feet of the boundaries of the subject property. And the staff's determination that the applicant has satisfied those requirements.
All right.
Okay.
Okay. And I guess at this time, because kind of before we started, I guess as soon as we, we'll go ahead and make that site visit available and reconvene here. What I would like to do also, Mr. Vigil, is at that time, we would talk about the rules of procedure that this hearing would take place, which is not actually defined, I believe, but we would set that procedure in place, rules of procedure for today's.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, that would be appropriate. We have provided you with the rules of procedure that we seek your adoption before we commence the public hearing.
Okay. So that would be the first order of business at 1 o'clock?
Mr. Chairman, that would be correct.
All right. Well, then, do we have travel?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, Mr. Corbett, yes, we have travel arranged. We would be utilizing the unsealed data, which is readily available outside.
Okay.
Hello.
Well, that's a really phone. All right, then we will reconvene at 1 o'clock after the site visit, and lunch and everything should take place during this time. All right. Thank you, Mr. Rito.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioner.
Welcome, everybody. We will now reconvene the meeting. We go ahead and call roll again?
Commissioner Romero?
Present.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Present.
Commissioner Blankenhorn?
Present.
Vice Chair Gallegos? Chairman Farrow?
Present. Motion to come back into session.
Second, Mr. Chairman.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Okay, thank you. All right, Mr. Taylor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and Mr. Chairman, Commissioners. As we previously discussed, there was a really big, before we adjourned to do the site inspection. Before we begin today's public hearing, Mr. Chairman, I respectfully request that you adopt the Planning Commission's rules of procedure, which are found in Section 8 of the Planning Commission bylaws, which we have provided for you. These would be letters A through Q, and that for letter Q, you advise that an appeal of this decision may be done in accordance with the Land Use Regulations, Section 10.1.3, Appeal of Decisions of the Board of County Commissioners. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, the rules of procedure will establish the process in which today's public hearing will be conducted in accordance with Robert's Rules of Order. I respectfully ask that any areas that reference the Planning Commission be removed and replaced by the Board of County Commissioners, and that the rules of procedure be adopted by a motion and a vote on a motion. Upon the rules of procedure being adopted, Mr. Chairman, it is appropriate for you to open the public hearing and read the rules of procedure into the record. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners.
Thank you. So, does everyone have a copy of that? So it's basically substituting the Board of County Commissioners for the Planning Commission. And one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10 places.
Mr. Chairman.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
I will set a motion that we adopt Section 8 of the Rules of Procedure with striking Planning Commission in 10 places, substituting Board of County Commissioners in 9, as Q already has Board of County Commissioners. As presented, that we adopt these rules of procedure A through Q with those additions.
Thank you, Commissioner.
I'll second, Mr. Chairman.
We have a motion and a second to adopt Section 8 rules of procedure A through Q, substituting Board of County Commissioners for County Commission wherever it is on the document.
Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Commissioner Blankenhorn?
Yes.
Chairman Farrow?
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Vito.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Those will be used from now on whenever we have any of these types of hearings, correct?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, it will be used when it is not an appeal.
Okay.
If there is an appeal, it is sections outlined in the land use regulations that is the standardized procedure for appeals in front of the Board of Adjustment. planning commission and the board of county commissioners.
Because the appeal procedures were already in the land use, right?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. You may proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, commissioners. And Mr. Chairman, as we move through the process, I would just respectfully ask you to indicate where we are in terms of the rules of procedure so that the audience could know when would they be accorded the opportunity to speak and when questions would be appropriate and that kind of stuff. And if I could just ask you, at this particular point, Mr. Chairman, it's very appropriate for you to go ahead and indicate that we are addressing letter eight on the rules of procedure that we just adopted, and you would just go ahead and indicate what letter eight states.
Letter A of the rules of procedure are as follows. The planning department staff shall give a brief synopsis of the project that is being proposed and will outline the action or actions required of the Board of County Commission. The Board of County Commissioners may ask questions of planning staff.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, commissioners. At this time, Mr. Chairman, commissioners, I would like to refer you to the orange three-ring binder that planning staff provided to you. And for a more clear description of what today's public hearing is, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to go ahead and read into the record the notice of a public hearing that was published in the local newspaper and the notice of public hearing that was provided to property owners within 1,000 feet of the subject of the proposed boundaries or the boundaries of the subject property. Mr. Chairman, commissioners, Mark Yard as agent and Glenn M. Charlton, managing partner of Venture 91LLP. Applicant representing the Tarleton Ranch PV system is requesting a major development permit. Major development permit 001-2016, commercial use for the construction-erection of a 1.2 to 1.3 megawatt alternating current solar array consisting of 3,888 photovoltaic solar panels on 7.7 acres of a 58-plus acre tract. The maximum height of each solar panel will be 7 feet 6 inches in height, but at the full 52 degree tilt. The proposal also includes the construction of three 50 foot by 4 foot and two 6 foot by 6 foot concrete equipment pads for the placement of inverters and transformers, etc., and the construction of a chain link fence with a 3-strand barbed wire fence for a combined height of 8 feet. Consisting of approximately 2,400 minimum feet around the perimeter of the 7.7 acres for security purposes. The proposal further includes the construction of a 16-foot wide access road from Valencia Road to the proposed site consisting of approximately 2,400 minimum feet and the construction of a hammerhead turn at the terminus. The electricity generated by solar panels will be sold to Kit Carson Electric Cooperative and delivered by underground cable within the PV site and onto an off-site overhead electrical transmission line. The proposed project is located at number 16 along the court off of County Road B-042, also known as Valencia Road in the lower Los Montes area, Taos County, New Mexico, and is further described as lying within Section 24, Township 26 North, a range of 12 East, and lying within the Antonio Martinez and Antoine Leroux Grant. Mr. Chairman, Commissioner, at this time I would like to refer you to tab P of the orange binder. Tab P of the orange binder represents the planning director's staff report to you, the Board of Planning Commissioners, regarding today's public hearing. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, on July 13th, 2016, the Taos County Planning Commission voted to conditionally recommend approval of major development permit 001-2016 to the Taos County Board of Commissioners in accordance with 4.6.6b as in boy 0.7 of Ordinance 2015-2 Taos County Land Use Regulations. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, you are being provided with the record of the Taos County Planning Commission hearing of July 13, 2016. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, as Exhibit A, you are being provided with a copy of the decision of the Planning Commission of the July 13, 2016 hearing, and their Planning Commission hearing is found under Exhibit A. Exhibit B should be recognized as the major development permit application 001-2016. And that is a separate three-ring binder that's provided to you, separate of this orange binder. Under Exhibit C, you have been provided with number one, the Planning Commission meeting agenda for July 13, 2016. Number two, the Planning Commission table of contents for July 13, 2016. Number three, the Planning Commission notice of public hearing. Number four, the treasurer's receipt in the amount of $750 for the major development permit fee for 001-2016. Number five, the assessor's printout designation for such a property as grazing. Under Exhibit D, you have been provided with the planning director's staff report to the Planning Commission. Under Exhibit E, you have been provided with various maps identifying location of such a property. Under Exhibit F, you have been provided with number one, the letter from the planning director to the agent deeming major development permit 001-2016 incomplete, dated June 8th, 2016. Number two, letter from the planning director to the applicant deeming major development permit number 1-2016 complete, dated June 15th, 2016. Under Exhibit G, you have been provided with the planning director's site inspection photographs. Under Exhibit H, you have been provided with number one, the affidavit from the applicant affirming notification of the July 13, 2016 public hearing to all owning property adjacent to within 1,000 feet of the edge of the proposed tract and the attached list of notification. Number two, copies of photographs affirming posting of the property. Number three, copy of a legal advertisement for the legal ad appearing in the Taos News on June 23rd, 2016. Under Exhibit I, you have been provided with a letter from Kit Carson Electric Cooperative Incorporated referencing the draft power purchase agreement amongst Kit Carson Electric and the applicant. Under Exhibit J, you have been provided copies of emails from individuals in support and individuals in opposition of the proposed major development permit. This was 001-2016. This emails are referencing the July 13, 2016 meeting and from the Planning Commission. Under Exhibit K, copy of the Taos County Building, Taos County Planning Department Tarleton Solar Array Distance to Nearest Buildings map. Under Exhibit L, copy of news article from Solar Builder Magazine submitted by the agent. Under Exhibit M, copy of the email from Nick Sanchez, Taos County Chief Appraiser to the agent dated July 11, 2016. Under Exhibit N, copy of the email from Luis Reyes, Kit Carson, CEO to the agent regarding overhead or underground power lines. In addition, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, you are being provided with the following. Under Exhibit O, Planning Director's Staff Report to the Board of County Commissioners dated August 8th, 2016. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, under Exhibit P, you are being provided with number one, the affidavit from the applicant affirming notification of today's public hearing to all persons owning property adjacent to and within 1,000 feet of the edge of the proposed tract and attached list of notification. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, I just want to do a little sidebar here right quick and indicate to you that the applicant provided this notification inclusive of the lower Dismontis Neighborhood Association. There was a question earlier before we broke that notification was not given to the neighborhood association. The applicant has affirmed they did provide notification to the Lower Dismontis Neighborhood Association and the attached affidavit dated August 12, 2016. And Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, number two, copies of, and then they also indicate, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, for the record, that notification was also provided to Taos Pueblo by first class mail. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, under number two of Exhibit P, a room provided by copies of photographs affirming posting of the property. Under number three, under Exhibit P, copy of legal advertisement, which appeared in the House News dated August 11, 2016, publishing today's public hearing. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, in addition, post-delivery of the application and supporting documentation to you, planning staff received an email from Dan Decker dated Sunday, August 21st, 2016. And this email states, I have many concerns about the recently approved plan to build a large commercial solar array on the Tarleton land. I feel that this is not the appropriate place for a solar array. I believe solar energy is important and should be set up in an appropriate place in the community. Many other communities nationwide have successfully created detailed processes and plans for incorporating solar energy by restricting the locations and the subject effect on neighbors. Though I do object to the location of the array, I realize it may move forward in the approval process. I would appreciate it if House Board members consider creating standards requiring requirements for lessening the impact both physical and visual on the neighborhood communities. Below are my suggestions for consideration as standard requirements. Bullet point number one, requiring screening of the array, including privacy fencing, and requiring vegetative berm to decrease the impact to neighbors. Bullet point number two, increase setbacks to minimize the impact on the neighbors. The present proposed 35 feet is way too close to the property line. Bullet point number three, vary the transmission line from the beginning of the project. And bullet point number four, create a plan to decommission the facilities once they are no longer and requirement to restore the site to its previous condition. I appreciate you forwarding this email to your board members. Thank you for your consideration. And Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, this is an email from Dan Decker dated August 21st, 2016. And we would introduce this as exhibit letter Q. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, in addition, we also received an email from Rob Wheeler dated August 26, 2016, also post-delivery of the packets to you. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, in Mr. Wheeler's email, Mr. Wheeler writes, please let this email serve as my formal opposition to the solar array project on Valencia Road presented by the Tarletons on August 30th. Please reference the letter from George Dean and Janet McCovia with respect to specific issues. For the record, I share 1,000 feet of the northwest border directly to the line of sight of the project. My land border disproportionately absorbs the line of sight of the nearly 4,000 solar panels. And attaching a plat to the affected geography and affected homeowners line of sight of my land clearly in the middle. Please see photo attachment noted in next email for the record. Respectfully submitted, Bob Wheeler. And Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, Mr. Wheeler has attached a couple of maps. Also, I'll introduce this as exhibit letter R.
Commissioner Bradford. Edward, I've got the letter here from George Dean and a memo, which was in my mailbox. I did not read it in accordance with our ex parte rules. So I'd ask to submit that on behalf of Mr. Dean.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, and Commissioner Blankenhorn, we as planning staff also received the letter from Mr. Dean, and we were prepared to introduce that into the record. Thank you for the head start. And Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, in the email attached with the letter from George and Amanda Dean received on August 29, 2016, Mr. Dean writes, on July 13, 2016, the Taos County Planning Commission approved the application for major development permit commercial use submitted by Venture 91 LLLP to construct 3,888 solar panels and related appurtenances on 7.7 acres of a 58-plus acre tract of land fronting on Valencia Road in the Lower Des Montes area of Taos County. Identified as PB System Major Development Permit 001-2016. The decision of the Planning Commission was filed with the County Clerk on July 29, 2016 in Book 919, page 99, and it is made part hereof by reference. We own a home and 40 acres of land located at number 29 Buggy Road, which property is situated north of the development just outside the 1,000 feet notice area. We oppose the development for the following reason. Under section 4.7.1 of the Development Compatibility Standards of Land Use Regulations, major development permits require that a use, letter A, use, the development shall be sensitive to and consistent with the existing traditional and historic uses in the neighborhood, or the applicant shall be able to demonstrate that the development would provide a substantial benefit to or support to, or would not have a substantial impact on the immediate neighborhood. Letter B, visual impact. The development shall be sensitive to and consistent with the architectural design, scale, density, bulk, building height, historical character and orientation of the existing properties in the neighborhood, or the applicant shall be able to demonstrate that the alternative being proposed is suitable to the land and the neighborhood character. This development is completely surrounded by a neighborhood which includes the historic Carlton Ranch, lands to the east, undeveloped rebel lands to the west, the historic Mariposa Ranch lands to the north, and single-family residential properties and subdivisions elsewhere on each side of Valencia from Highway 522 to its junction of Highway 230. The traditional and historic uses in this neighborhood have been agricultural, grazing, residential, and recreational, including for hunting and wildlife. Wildlife habitats such as deer, elk, coyotes, rabbits, dove, quail. This neighborhood has never been used for any commercial or industrial purpose. Accordingly, this project is, by its very nature, number one, insensitive to and inconsistent with existing traditional and historic uses in the neighborhood. Number two, does not conform to the land and neighborhood character. And number three, while the project may provide a personal benefit to the applicant, it will not provide a benefit to the surrounding property, but rather an adverse visual and environmental impact to such property. Nevertheless, without any demonstration that the development satisfies these requirements, the Planning Commission summarily concluded that the development is so sensitive to, consistent with, and visually compatible with the traditional, historic, and existing property uses in the neighborhood. The decision of the Planning Commission is arbitrary, capricious, and clearly contrary to the explicit requirements of the land use regulations. We believe a major commercial use development is inappropriate in our to our neighborhood and belongs in a commercial or industrial use area. Its proximity to an electrical substation, accordingly, we respectfully request that the application be denied. Once again, this is from George and Amanda Dean, and Mr. Chairman, Commissioner, we introduce this to you as Exhibit S. Thank you for your patience. I'm going to take just a few more minutes of your time before we yield to the applicant. I will refer you to page 3, once again, of the staff report, which is identified in letter O of the three-ring binder, or exhibit O of the three-ring binder. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, it is my determination that the applicant has complied with the notification requirements for today's hearing, including the appearance of a legal advertisement in the local newspaper, which appeared on August 11, 2016. Letters of notification to adjacent property owners within 1,000 feet of the boundaries of the subject property, notices mailed on August 12, 2016, and the posting of the property. Also, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, today's hearing is in compliance with section 4.6.6B10, which requires that the Board of County Commissioners within 45 calendar days after the filing of the written decision of the Planning Commission, which decision was filed on July 29, 2016. Today's hearing is being held within 32 days of the filing of the decision. The application, Major Drawing Permit 001-2016, shall be considered by the Board of County Commissioners at a public hearing. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, if I could just ask for a minute. I apologize that I failed to provide the county clerk with a copy of the application and the three-ring binder that we referenced. So for the record, we're just providing this to the county clerk as well.
Thank you.
In accordance with section page 4 of the Planning Director's staff report, in accordance with section 4.6.6B.7, the role of the Board of County Commissioners today is to adopt adopt with conditions, modify or deny the major development application based on the performance standards set forth in sections 4.7 and 4.8 and/or sections 4.9 through 4.15. As per the site inspection conducted today, the Board of County Commissioners cannot act as a witness on the matter. Further, the Board of County Commissioners is acting as a quasi-judicial body where you are required to hold a hearing, weigh the evidence, and draw conclusions from them as a basis for your action and to exercise discretion of a judicial nature. A quasi-judicial nature does not include policy-making activities that are engaged when the legislative function is being exercised. Unlike legislative decisions, a quasi-judicial decision must be based solely on the evidence presented and cannot be based on opinions related to the facts presented at the hearing. Put differently, a quasi-judicial decision is one that requires the hearing body to find facts that exercise discretion when applying the standards of an ordinance to a specific situation. Members of the Board of County Commissioners must act as a quasi-judicial capacity when participating in public hearings under the Taos County Land Use Regulations, which is Ordinance 2015-2. As such, only the highest degree of integrity in the process by the member ensures the public's trust in an impartial decision. No ex parte communication should occur outside of the hearing. Ex parte means private communications with one party to the case without the other present. All members must be unbiased and not have a personal interest in the outcome. For example, a commission member who owns an adjacent lot to the proposed development should reveal the potential interest and with the county attorney decide if the personal interest creates a legal bias that would require a recusal from the case. The attorney will let the commissioner know if the personal interest needs to be shared with the commission at the hearing and whether it requires a recusal. If the major development application fails to satisfy all of the applicable standards or the applicant fails to obtain a variance, the application shall be denied. If the major development application is in compliance with the applicable performance standards, the Board of County Commissioners shall approve the major development application. The decision shall be recorded with the office of the county clerk within 30 calendar days of the date of the public hearing. It is the planning director's determination that the applicant has complied with the applicable submittal requirements and the performance standards necessary to have major development permit application 001-2016 deemed complete. In doing so, the planning director in a letter dated June 15, 2016, deemed major development permit 001-2016 complete as per section 4.6.5 of the major development plan submittal, letter B as in boy. The planning director waived the following after determining that the submittal requirements identified below were inappropriate or unnecessary to determine whether the application satisfies the applicable standards. The numbers in these items that the planning director waived, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, they're not sequential numbers because these are the way the numbers appear in the land use regulations. So number 10 in the land use regulations, affordable and/or workforce housing. The proposal is for an unmanned photovoltaic solar facility and therefore this requirement is waived. Number 12, development phasing schedule. There are no plans to construct a proposed photovoltaic solar facility in phases. The project is expected to become operational within 4 months from obtaining approval from the Board of County Commissioners and therefore this requirement is waived. Number 15, lighting plan. As previously stated, the proposal is for an unmanned photovoltaic facility, and that will not require exterior lighting, including freestanding security lighting, and therefore this requirement is waived. Number 19, complete traffic impact study. As this is an unmanned facility, post-construction traffic is of little or no impact. There will only be a small increase in construction equipment during the construction of the facility on Valencia Road, County Road B-042, and little or no impact from Valencia Road onto Milano Lee and Alondra Court for these portions of the roadways are all part of the overall 58-plus acre tract owned by the applicant Venture 91LLP, and therefore this requirement is waived. Number 22. physical map and narrative, letter B, hydrology survey, letter C, water supply plan, and letter D, sewage treatment plan. Once again, as this is an unmanned photovoltaic solar facility that does not require the use of water other than water to be used during construction of the access road and the development of the site for dust abatement. Also, in being an unmanned facility, there will be no liquid waste disposal discharge other than during the construction phases, which is a portable liquid waste disposal unit will be provided. Therefore, the requirements identified in 22B, C, and D are waived. Number 23, disclosure statement. The planning director has determined that since the subject property is not being offered for sale or lease, a written document allowing a prospective purchaser or leasing to make an informed decision about the purchase or lease of the land or improvements to the land is not necessary, and therefore this requirement is also waived. Number 25, list of approved variance applications. There are no variances associated with Major Development Permit 001-2016, and therefore this item is waived. Further, as per Section 4.8.1 Administrator Special Use and Major Development Performance Standards, the Planning Department shall submit a written report to the Planning Commission and or the Board of County Commissioners outlining the application's compliance with these standards as the basis for rendering any decision to approve, approve with conditions, or disapprove the application for a special use for major development. The applicant shall provide engineered drawings, a written explanation and analysis of all the standards identified in this section, or a written substantiation as to why they do not apply. Mr. Chairman, Commissioner, on page 6 of the Planning Director's staff report, the applicant has identified items A, B, C, D, H, M, and W as not applicable. Under letter A, roads, road standards, the applicant submitted a written substantiation as to why 4.8.1A roads and Appendix 1 road standards does not apply, and the planning director concurs with the substantiation provided by the applicant. Under letter B, utilities, the applicant submitted a written substantiation as to why Section 4.8.8B utilities, all water, sewage, electric, phone lines, cable, and natural gas shall be underground, does not apply, and the planning director supports the substantiation provided by the applicant. Under letter C, water supply and quality, the applicant submitted a written substantiation as to why 4.8.1C water supply and quality do not apply, and the planning director concurs with the substantiation provided by the applicant. Letter D, liquid waste disposal. Once again, a substantiation was provided by the applicant. Planning director concurs with the substantiation. Letter H, environmental impact study. The planning director determined that since the proposed project is considered low impact, an environmental impact study is not necessary. Further, Mr. Chairman, Commissioner, further as the basis for the planning director determining that a EIS is not required, we recognize that environmental studies aim to ensure welfare of today's society as well as future generations. However, careful thought and consideration was given as to whether or not to make a determination as your planning director to provide notice to the applicant of the basis of the need to require an environmental impact study as allowed for in Section 4.8.1, letter H, environmental impact study. After a couple of site inspections and the pre-application conference with the applicant, I determined that I would not request that the applicant complete an environmental impact study created by an environmental professional. My basis for the determination is not requiring the EIS is as follows. Number one, solar photovoltaic systems, as I understand them, generate no pollution. The direct conversion of sunlight to electricity occurs within without any moving parts. Number two, a slight traffic impact on Valencia Road may occur during the construction of the array. Otherwise, little or no impact on Valencia Road once constructed. There is anticipated one vehicle trip every 2 weeks or every month for inspection and maintenance of the array. Number three, the array is an unmanned facility with no construction of any type of runs where there is no need for water. thus no need to drill a water well. Only water use will be during construction of the site for dust abatement and during construction. No need for liquid waste disposal, thus no need for a liquid waste disposal unit. Portable sanitary unit will replace the job site during construction, where it will be the responsibility of the applicant to schedule cleanings as necessary. Number four, all improvements are located on Tarleton property, including the construction of Milano Road and Alondra Court. Number five, storm water will be contained within the Tarleton property. Number six, little or no noise from the panels, possibly low noise, usually associated with the installation of inverters, which could be a system other than in construction, which could be possibly heard after the construction is done. Number seven, but there are ways to mitigate that possible noise from the inverters. Number seven, no known wildlife located on the subject property. Number eight, no acequias located on the subject property, and even if there were, no discharge from the system. Number nine, once again, no exterior lighting. Number 10, no known geologically unstable areas. Number 11, the site is not located within a floodplain. Number 12, no known archaeological sites on the site. Number 13, is not located within a wildland urban interface area. Number 14, minimum solid waste, trash generated during construction. Number 15, the nearest residential structure is over 1,000 feet away. Number 16, the site is not being used for agricultural purposes, but rather for grazing. Number 17, Milano Loop and Alondra Court are being constructed to a lesser width than what would be required if a subdivision was being developed or constructed, the width being 16 feet rather than 22 feet. And lastly, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, number 18, minimal fuels. And the fuel will only be associated during construction, otherwise no fuels will be associated with this project. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, back to letter M, exterior lighting. The planning director has determined that since the proposed project does not propose any type of lighting, exterior lighting does not apply. Letter W, wildland urban interface impact areas. The area is not located within a wildland or impact area, so therefore this area does not apply. The planning director has considered if the site guidelines found in section 4.12.2 and evaluating the appropriateness of proposed location for solar projects and the proposed project components has determined that Major Development Permit 001-2016 complies with this section. It should be stated, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, that clarification on the setbacks, while the decision of the Planning Commission and the Planning Director's staff report site setbacks of 35 feet and 30 feet and 30 feet respectively, the application from its inception and submittal to the Planning Department has referenced a 50-foot setback around the entire perimeter of the subject property. So any reference to a setback less than 50 feet is inaccurate, and it should be reflected as 50 foot. That is just something to bear in mind, that the setbacks that are identified in the decision of the Planning Commission and staff reports, Planning Director staff report, are inaccurate. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, I respectfully reserve the opportunity to come before you to present my findings and recommendations after the applicant has presented Major Development Permit 001-2016 to you. After those wishing to speak in support of the application and after those wishing to speak in opposition have had the opportunity to do so. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, if you have any questions of me, I stand for questions. Otherwise, I would respectfully ask that we move along with the rules of procedure and move on to letter B and allow the applicant to present their application to you. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners.
Mr. Chairman, I just have one quick question, if I may.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
This exhibit of Rob Wheeler, I share 1,000 feet on the northwest border. I don't see him noticed. Apparently he's out of the, I don't understand what he's saying here. So he wasn't noticed. He's not in the 1,000 foot.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner O'Donnell, it is our understanding that he is outside of the 1,000 foot area notice. Otherwise he would have received a letter of notification.
Thank you.
And Mr. Chairman, Commissioner, if I may, I also meant to indicate and introduce into the record that we received an email from Dr. Stanley Ribelis, R-I-D-E-L-E-S, who is also in support of the application. I meant to introduce that earlier, and I don't have an email readily available. I want to indicate that as the into the record account.
Thank you.
So, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, it is very appropriate for you to go ahead and identify letter B as to what the next process in our procedure will be now.
Item B in the rules of procedure is previously adopted. The petitioner, applicant, appellate, or other person bringing matter before the Bureau Board of County Commissioners, hereinafter the applicant, shall be allowed up to 20 minutes in which to present their application.
Do you swear and affirm under oath and penalty of law for perjury that the testimony you're about to give is true and factual?
I do. My name is Mark Yarvitz. I'm an agent for the applicant, Mr. Tarleton, who's sitting next to me here. I'm going to talk for just a quick few minutes about the solar array project, and then Mr. Tarleton will discuss some of the more physical details of it. Some of this information is from the Planning and Zoning Commission hearing previously, and I understand that this is a new application process, so I will be repeating some of that information that you may have in front of you. The economic impact of this solar array, this is a $2.3 million construction project for the community. $1.9 million in materials and over $400,000 in labor. It'll generate approximately $175,000 in gross receipts tax with an annual property tax of approximately $20,000 a year. Second part of this is the Kit Carson master plan that you're all aware of to achieve a significant amount of alternative energy in your long-term goals. We did discuss a lot of this with Mr. Reyes while we were preparing the application in terms of making sure it was compatible. There's just a little bit of information from that, those conversations I'd like to pass on. As you all know, the buyout of the tri-state contract, as well as getting rid of that 5% cap on solar array, now makes it possible for our community to head in the direction and approach. You can't hit 100% for a variety of reasons, but you can push the limit on that. This means that there will be approximately 20 to 25 of these solar arrays throughout Taos County in the next 10 years to hit that goal. We are called the solar capital of the world for a variety of reasons, because solar energy is more efficient at this elevation. It cools down faster at night. It is, you get more electric per solar panel than you do at other places. Our longitude latitude makes this a really excellent place to do solar. The solar array grids, the solar array has to be placed around the grid in areas of load. You cannot put all solar arrays in one place out by the airport to cover Taos County. They have to be placed close to residential neighborhoods all around Taos County, these 20 to 25, in order to reach those goals. The grid can only accept one solar array in one location because of the limitations of the power supply. So the existing infrastructure, the ability to connect to the grid is very important. And so whether or not we allow Taos to go forward with more and more solar arrays is a question on the table in front of you. Mr. Ray said that his members have been demanding more of him to do solar arrays, more alternative energy, less lessening the carbon footprint. We all know those arguments. He also mentioned that this may be the first solar array that he's been dealing with where he's seen any opposition. He was confused by that. The array in Amalia is part of their show and tell. They have a tour up there. They're proud of their solar array. The same for the UNM-Taos solar array. People like to see it. They like to go look at it. It's great to see that we're doing something in that direction. And both UNM and the Amalia arrays are proud to take people on those tours. The Tomb Drive neighborhood, Mr. Reyes told us, was asking for a solar array out there and some land they wanted to donate to accommodate their load. the terrain that this is being located on is some minor undulating hills, and most of it is not seen from a variety of locations. I know that a couple of commissioners had an opportunity to drive out there and look at this location to see what we're talking about. The question, from that distance, you can see the airport lights, you can see the dump from there, you can see a lot of things. This is lower than that horizon. Question, does a private residence have a protected view corridor that is unlimited when it comes to solar arrays, when these get placed around Taos County? One of the main arguments against the solar array is property tax values. I hear that as the issue on the table from a lot of different situations. Whatever it is, we don't want it because it's going to devalue my property. I have a letter that I want to enter into the record. Carlton, if you would... I'm going to, I don't know if I need to read this on the record or not. It was at the Planning Commission. I read it on the record there. It's in your exhibit. I'm going to read you some of the highlights from Mr. Nick Sanchez, your chief assessor here. I asked him a question about property value appraisals and diminution in value from a solar array. Mark, I was a fee appraiser from 1995 to 2006. Certified residential, then certified general, and evaluation protest chair for most New Mexico counties from 2000 to 2011, not to mention Taos County chief appraiser for the past 5 years. During my tenure as an appraiser, I've encountered situations just like your subject, solar array property. At the Sandoval County evaluation protest hearings, there were protests over the massive water tank and PNM electric substations that were built during the housing explosion from Bernalillo to Rio Rancho. Many of the protests were live before construction started, stating that the values are declining due to the proposed construction. In most cases, protesters stated that the improvements were good and necessary, did not want them where they could be seen from their own home sites. Of course, they stated that property values were lower and that they wanted tax relief on the injured properties. Not one protestant was able to provide market data to defend their protest. After construction, there were new and renewed protests for the same reason. Again, not one protestant could bring before an aftermarket sales information that would substantiate their claims, became an enhancement to some nearby areas that previously required well and septics. The next section, I'm not going to read all of this, about the New Mexico Railroad and his sister owned property in that area. And again, I was a free appraiser at the time and I checked comparables in the immediate and overall market area where the railroad station and tracks were going to ascertain whether or not they were paying market values for their homes. Again, there was no impact on value. Here in Taos in the early 60s, friends and I rode horses from Ranchitos to the Gorge and back. I'll skip through some of this. A Taos County property owner provided sales of properties in that area, which increased the value of the property rather than decrease it from claims of things that were going to devalue it. I'll just read to the last section here. I believe that the same outcome is inevitable to the proposed solar array we spoke of. As far as I know, there is no such thing as a crystal ball, so how can anyone say that losses in property value are inevitable? I have never seen it as an appraiser since 1995. I heard that the same claims and outlandish claims of property value loss regarding towers and wind generation in central New Mexico, the same reasons expressed as mentioned above and the same results ensued. I just have never seen it happen. Nick Sanchez, Taos County Chief Appraiser. Property values are more attuned with what Mr. Bacon does in the Ski Valley, with how your house is built, with how it's situated, with all kinds of other things, but Mr. Sanchez says not from the solar array. The carbon offset. This array will power over 375 homes per year. That's the impact. It's the equivalent of planting 221 acres of forests. This array is now more efficient than the last array placed in Costilla on 14 acres, This is only on 7 acres with the setbacks. It's actually 5.5 acres of a footprint. It is now 3,888 panels for the same power output as the 5,288 panels from the Amalia array. These will only be 7 feet high. We planted some poles with a flag on them for you to see. Actually, when they're being used, they're probably more like 4.5 feet high. It's only when they tilt up during certain times will they actually reach that height. The amount of ground being disturbed underneath is minimal, but just on platforms. Grazing can still occur with whatever animals may or may not care to graze out there. This was a project once that had an application in for a 24-lot subdivision, which was pulled because of the real estate recession we experienced in 2008. Sometime in the future, we hope to bring back that application for putting residential homes around the solar array, and for people that will be happy to live in an area where they're getting some green energy commitment. Who's to say that a solar energy project doesn't add value to your property rather than deter it? Again, as we mentioned earlier, this project has no moving parts, no heat, no light, no employees, no any impact whatsoever once it's started. And we'd like the opportunity to proceed with that. I'm going to turn some of this over to Mr. Carlton to talk about some of the parts and bones of the structure.
Do you swear and affirm under oath and penalty of loss or perjuries that the testimony you're about to give is true and factual?
I do.
Please state your name.
Glenn Michael Carlton. Thank you, commissioners. I just wanted to tell you that what we tried to do was conform with the latest version of the Lower Des Moines Neighborhood Land Use Plan, which I got off of the internet. I'm also a member of that organization by owning land in that area. And what we're falling under in, with our property and the property all the way up to including Buggy Road is what they call designated a sustainable community. This sustainable community land is areas that should be developed in a manner that encourage sustainable community practice such as energy systems. And what I want to show you here is our 58 acres that shows that with Valencia Road on the right and our photovoltaic system on the upper left corner covering 5.5 acres, 7.7 acres if you include the 50-foot setback which surrounds the array there. I'd like to show you also that to the south of our property line down there, we are showing how we will connect the system to the utility grid, where we drop down to the south, turn the corner, and move to the east, and connect with an existing line that serves our houses on our property where we live. There would be an additional three poles to carry that. The reason we want to do the poles is we're still, like Mark Yarovitz mentioned, we're still planning our development up there for residential. But once we do that in a phased timetable, and we have to bury water, power, communications, gas, natural gas, and all that, at that time, when we open up all the roads and bury all the utilities underground, at that time is when we would put this line underground, because it would be a lot easier to do it all then rather than bury it now and then have to dig it up and move it and rebury it. The sustainable, what I want to show you with this diagram is what the Lower Des Moines Neighborhood Use is calling their sustainable community. In their sustainable community, which is the orange you see, the total left-hand part of that is where I drew a little square. That would be our photovoltaic facility right there. The edge of the orange and the lighter white to your right, that's Buggy Road from Valencia going up to the right. You want to point that up, Buggy Road, just a little bit to your right. That's Valencia Road, right? The Buggy Road is where the two colors change, right there. Nope, to your up, go. That's Buggy Road there where the two colors converge, which is over a half a mile from the array. Now, the lighter color one there that he's pointing out is your rural residential neighborhood. The other one, the orange where I have my array, is what they're also allowing for sustainable community, which means schools, offices, filling stations, auto repair stores, anything that you find in town that's commercial. So, and it includes a notation called energy systems, which is part of what's also allowed in that neighborhood already. I think we just ran out of our 20 minutes of time, so.
You actually have just over 2 minutes left.
Do you have any questions for us?
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Could you reiterate again how much we would see from a property tax increase and the GRTs, Mr. Yarovitz?
I spoke to the assessor's office and roughly a $2 million project based upon the income from a project like that and the debt service, et cetera, taking the value, dividing by 3 times the mill levy of approximately 0.2 is about $20,000 a year. The gross receipts tax is, I think, in the county 7.8% of $2.3 million, and that's about $175,000 in gross receipts tax from this project.
So that would be, we're receiving GRTs on the labor and the
construction? The whole project has to be, will be GRT assessed, labor and materials.
And the property tax of $20,000 a year has to do with a reassessment of the 5.5 acres once it's filled out?
Right, the 7.5 acres will be split out by the assessor as an income-producing property, and it will be evaluated based on the cost to duplicate or to do the project again. I talked about the various mechanisms for what the appraisal was, and we came up with about $20,000 until they actually do it. It's not confirmed, but that's pretty close.
And then I noticed there are two banks committing, which would bring the total price up to 4.3.
No.
You have a Sentinel loan commitment of $2 million and a People's Bank commitment of 2.3. Is that, you're going to just pick one
we're
of those banks?
We're shopping the loan between the two banks and also a third opportunity as well. So it's about a $2.3 million project when it's totally complete, and the loan versus whatever cash is put in the deal will be what the debt service will be, yes.
And then could you talk about the USDA grant, how much you would receive from
the
that?
USDA grant is on hold at the moment, and the final draft or the final negotiation with both the banks and with Kit Carson will only be determined by the outcome of this meeting. Otherwise, we have nothing to discuss.
All right, because I did notice you referenced it here in the exhibit two at the end of exhibit two.
For which the USDA grant?
Yes, the USDA
grant. Right, the federal government has run out of money once again.
Okay, thank you very much.
Mr. Blankenbaum, is there any recurring gross receipts tax from the sale of electricity?
I don't believe so. It's a wholesale sale that goes to Kit Carson as the direct. With the PPA, the way it's written, they are the buyer of electricity at a wholesale price. At that point, no.
And is there a guarantee that the lines will eventually be buried, or is that contingent upon future development plans?
The burying of those three poles, or the line leading from Valencia West, from the existing overhead line that we will attach to, we would bury those lines as soon as we develop that property, the rest of that 58 acres, which we're planning on doing. As soon as the economy turns around, we can sell lots again. Currently, we have two subdivisions on our property, and we haven't sold a lot for, I guess, about 7 or 8 years now, but we're hoping to start up again.
Would you add in some guarantee over some period of time?
Yes, well, we have our, book that we put together for the subdivision, and it says that all utilities will be buried.
Right, according to subdivision law, that's a requirement. But if you never do the subdivision, then the lines will not be buried.
Well, we could be doing anything, I guess, not necessarily just a subdivision, in which case, I wanted to point out, too, that just south of us, the adjoining property that's just to the south of us has 11 poles right now in that area, covering maybe 5 acres. So I don't think three temporary poles additional would really upset anything.
Yeah, I was just trying to get a feel for how temporary they were. But
yeah. Well, depends on the economy, sir.
This is the location of the, there's one pole here and another one connected to the 11 pole grid that's already in place surrounding this community. All of the power in this section here is all above ground.
Mr. Vigo, I'm guessing that we've migrated to item C, the first portion of that. Would you like to read that at this time?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, if I may, before we advise or ask if any of you have any additional, any of the remaining commissioners have any additional questions before we migrate on to letter C. I would just like to indicate for the record that the proposed overlay that the applicants are utilizing for the Lower Bismarck's Neighborhood Association is strictly a proposal. It has not been formally approved, and that is the proposed overlay from the Lower Bismarck's Neighborhood Association. And reference to it should be as a proposal, not as what is presently existing on the ground right now.
I just have one more email to read, if I might, from Luis Reyes. We talked about the poles, et cetera. Mark, Kit Carson will build either overhead or underground based on the preference of the member requesting. However, the cooperative prefers overhead construction based on lower construction costs, lower operating costs, lower lifetime maintenance costs, lower replacement costs, and generally quicker restoration costs due to being able to locate faults and overhead systems as opposed to underground systems.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, in terms of the rules of procedure, if no other commissioners have any other questions of the applicant, you could move on to letter C.
Okay. After the applicant presents their application as listed in item C, questions will be allowed from the Board of County Commissioners and or members of the audience. Questioners need not be sworn in, but are required to identify themselves by name and residence. And if your name is something a little tricky, at least spell it out for us so the sandbox can get right in the minutes. Thank you for that. Are there any questions from the audience to Mr. Yarvet or to Mr. Tuller on the testimony that they and their presentation. Seeing none at this time, moving on to item D, the chairperson shall have all the members of the public who wish to address the Board of County Commissioners to sign up to speak. You were allowed to do that earlier. Members of the public will then be allowed to present their support for the project, followed by those wishing to speak in opposition. Each member of the public will be allowed up to 5 minutes for their presentation and will be sworn by another public prior to speaking. Ms. Sandoval will swear anyone in prior to your making your presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioners, as per the sign-in sheet, the first person who signed up is Lawrence Baker.
This is support.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, it's not identified as individual as to whether there's support or opposition. I'm just going on the chronologic numbering of the sign-in sheet.
Because according to the rules of procedure, we would want to hear from the supporters first and the opposition.
Okay.
Second. So if you are here and you support the project and you signed up to speak, please let Mr. Vigil know where you are on the list and your recommendation. Okay. The next phase of this will be to anyone wishing to speak in opposition. Oh, Mr. Hill, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Raise your right hand. Do you swear and affirm under oath and penalty of law for perjury that the testimony you're about to give is true and factual?
Yes.
My name?
Neil Billick. I'm in support of this proposal. I went out today with everybody else and viewed the property. It's unlikely that there'll be any impact, any visual impact with the distance from the residents. I highly support the residents that are in opposition, but I think they're, whatever they're opposition would be, I think it might be unfounded. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Spitz.
Do you swear and affirm under oath and penalty of law for perjury that the testimony you're about to give is true and factual?
I do.
Please state your name for the record.
My name is Dan Weiner. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, thank you. I'm in support of this project. I am President and CEO of PPC Solar, a local solar installation company. And although we have no direct ties with this project at this point, we do support solar projects in this in our area here, and we are in full support of this project. Green local energy being produced here is, as said, there is tax incentives for the county, not only immediately, but ongoing through the process of this. So I think it's a benefit. It also stabilizes our electrical system and provides us with local renewable energy, which is a must for our community. And also I think a lot of the opposition that are worried about visual aspects, and I think a lot of that is perceived. If you actually take a look at some of the solar arrays that have been built around here that are, you know, built in the same manner as this one is proposed, you'll see that they're actually very invisible. We've built quite a few of these around here. We built the one in UNM, we built Blue Sky out by airport, we built the array in Amalia. So we have a lot of experience in this, and I think the positives definitely outweigh any potential negatives that can be perceived. And thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else in support? Okay. Now I ask the members of the audience who signed up to speak to Mr. Vigil, will call you forward.
I'm Lawrence Baker, so I'm the first one on the list.
Do you swear and affirm under oath and penalty of law for perjury that the testimony you're about to give is true and factual?
special.
I do. So all of you commissioners know me. I've talked to all of you at one point or another, so you know exactly where I'm coming from. And you know what a vision I have also. One thing that, of course, you, Commissioner Fambro, will know about is this ex parte. So I just want to bring this up really quickly, because you've not been allowed to see this project or have anything to do with this project except with what the staff has provided you. I'm not exactly clear how any argument I can make or anyone else can make to persuade you differently, judging from what Mr. Vigil said to you. But it seems to me, when you have a very narrow reading of ex parte, as we do here, as well as in the city, you really have the most egregious thing about ex parte, because you have only seen what the staff has given you, and the staff is recommending this project wholeheartedly. So I didn't quite understand where any of my testimony might even have any effect on you, judging from what Mr. Vigil said. So I just want to bring that up. It seems to be, this ex parte ruling seems to be very weighted with the staff. That aside, I don't have an immediate dog in this fight. I don't live there. But my background is real estate. I come from Baltimore, and they had, beginning in the 1900s, a really good way of planning their developments. They had all their expensive houses in the middle, and as you go out, they got less and less and less and less expensive. That protected all of the property values. Their main, they had, in the north part of Baltimore, they had one main drag that went up. All the supports went up that main drag and that main drag. So all of those properties in that area were protected. And you know what? I sold my house there, and the woman who bought my house sold it, and her property values did not go down in this recession when everybody else, I mean, I lost $100,000 here. So this is one thing I'd like you to consider sort of in the long run. This isn't, I don't know what you know, whether you say it or not, this is an upzoning. This is going from residential to an industrial facility. I mean, you put lipstick on this pig, but it is still going to be a pig. It is still going to be an industrial facility. So I would like you, I would urge you to consider that. Mr. Bacon has doing all these great things up in the Ski Valley. I was told last night at the town meeting that the county is getting all kinds of applications for houses because Airbnb is seems to be the current thing. So is that true? Are you getting bunches of applications to build individual houses, Mr. Vigil?
No, we are not.
Okay. Well, that's what I was told. But anyway, it just seems to me that this very pristine land is ripe for really thoughtful development. And if you put an industrial complex there, even though I'm all for solar, but to me solar goes out 64, it doesn't go out 522. So I think you have to look at this in the long run and get the longer picture. Where are your revenues going to come from in the long run? So you're going to have GRTs for 4 months, boom, they're gone. You're going to have $20,000 a year in rent or in taxes. So you've got roughly 8 acres of solar panels, and then you're going to have 58 acres. Now, I just read something that said, no, they're not going to do solar panels on all 58. So is that true?
Yes, yes.
Well, I think I get that in writing. If I were you and I okayed this permit, I think I would say you can't do solar panels on any more than these 8 acres. That's what I'd do.
Thank you, Ms. Speaker.
And my 5 minutes are up.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.
Tell Mark to get a better mustache.
Tell me what?
Tell Mark to get a better mustache.
Oh, yeah, I can't wait till he gets to get rid of it on Monday.
Thank you for your time.
Thanks.
Please raise your right hand. Do you swear and affirm under oath and penalty of law for perjury that the testimony you're about to give is true and factual?
I do.
Please state your name for the record.
I'm Janet Makoviak, and my husband and I own a home within line of sight, but outside of the 1,000-foot notification area. Thank you for the opportunity today to voice our concerns about this proposed solar commercial development in the residential and agricultural area. You may have seen, I put a column in the paper this week or last week, and this is a picture of the UNM solar array that I took. So that's just a visual of what a solar array looks like, and that was taken at some distance. We are opposed to the location of this project, but we do support solar energy. We urge you to carefully consider this proposal because the decision you make today will impact all future sites for additional solar arrays in this county. As you heard from Mr. Yarovitz, 20 to 25 of these locations over the next 10 years throughout our county. And he also said they would be near residential neighborhoods. So you're setting a precedent with the decision you make with the first one. What is the overall plan? Do you have a map of where all of these are going to be? Do you know? Does Kit Carson know? That worries me. So I'm speaking today for my little neighborhood where we only have four houses, but eventually we will have more. You know, other property owners want to build. But I feel that we have a responsibility to the rest of this county with what you do today, and that's why I wanted to talk, and that's why I wrote that article. So Mr. Dean's letter to you that was submitted by Mr. V. Hill talked about the rules under your regulations, and I know you know your rules about the development being sensitive to and consistent with existing traditional and historic uses in the neighborhood, and that the applicant shall demonstrate that the development would provide substantial benefit or support to, or would not have a substantial impact on the immediate neighborhood, and that the development be sensitive to and consistent with the architectural design, that's not relevant, but to the existing properties, or demonstrate that it's suitable to the land and neighborhood and character. Our neighborhood is historic ranch lands, undeveloped pueblo lands, and single-family residential properties. I'm actually disappointed that the pueblo is not here today also taking a stand, because as you saw on that map, their land is immediately contiguous to this. This is not at the appropriate location for a massive solar array covering more than twice the amount of land as the huge solar array at UNM-Taos. As my husband and I have traveled around since we learned of this project, we've been really trying to pay attention to what we see in other cities and other states. And they are predominantly located in commercial and industrial areas. But when you do see them adjacent to or in the midst of a residential community, there is always some type of screening. I was just in Colorado Springs yesterday. They had a fence between the solar array and the residential property. With Kit Carson's move towards more solar power under the contract with Guzman Energy, you, our county commissioners, will be tasked with ensuring that Taos County does the right thing in properly planning for these arrays and protecting the view sheds that make this place so special. Improper planning and lack of strict rules and guidelines will impact property values and subsequently impact your tax revenues. You know, like Mr. Yarovitz said in his, what he read from Mr. Sanchez, nobody knows, but my gut tells me if that's right up next to a solar, next to a residential neighborhood, it's going to impact it. I'm concerned, despite all the reasons why you should not approve this, that you will.
So if you do, please comply with all aspects of your own commercial solar generation performance standards and application requirements filed on June 13, 2014. Require that the setbacks are significantly increased. I just don't think that 50 feet on a project of this scale is enough. Would you want this 50 feet from your property boundary? Bury the transmission lines from day one. Am I out of time?
We're close.
Okay.
Few
seconds. Okay, I'll go fast. I'm really worried that, you know, it's, I think Mr. Talton just said it's been 7 or 8 years he's been trying to sell property and it hasn't happened. I don't want it to be 20 years before those lines are buried underground. I've had a piece of land for sale that I can't sell either. So I would like to request that there be an earthen berm with vegetative screening to mitigate the eyesore and install screening fencing around the inverters, and that there be a requirement that the entire installation be removed if it's not being utilized, and that the land be restored to its natural state. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, Mr. Deal.
Please raise your right hand. Do you swear and affirm under oath and penalty of law for perjury that the testimony you're about to give is true and factual?
I do.
Please state your name.
My name is Sam Rivelis. I live off of Valencia in the neighborhood of Janet McCobiak. I read her editorial. I think she's raised a number of reasonable and constructive suggestions for conditions that would be useful and helpful to the neighbors if they were implemented with the project in the short run. So although I speak as an opponent, it's a sort of unless certain conditions are fulfilled, in the same sense that, as I understand it, there are several dozen conditions under subject to which you will also approve the project. If it is approved, I've read through those conditions. I would like to say there's a short-term and a long-term problem. The short-term problem is the visibility and footprint of the solar array. I believe the suggestions that Janet has made are extremely helpful and useful and should be taken fully into account. The developers said at the planning meeting that I also attended and made my concerns evident that they would consider the visibility of the fence. I would also like to suggest that they bury the transmission lines both in their own interest and in the interest of the residents. There will be a 1,000-foot string of telephone poles if they go forward with above ground transmission lines. There are no telephone poles on Valencia today from the point of the mobile home park to the end of Valencia. Putting telephone poles along the mesa will be extremely visible. They will undo the very efforts that the developers will make to shield the solar panels themselves and to modify the fencing. So I would urge you to take that under consideration. I agree with Janet's concern with the long-term impact. I think you're setting a precedent here. I think you will, the future commissioners will rely on this kind of a decision and this kind of a logic for moving forward. So I would suggest that these suggestions for reducing visibility and footprint, protecting the integrity of the landscape, I think will serve the developers in the long run when they themselves will want to develop and sell that property, and the residents will not want the visibility of that solar array to impact their own development. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, that concludes the summary list.
Okay. At this time, Mr. Neal, is it appropriate to read item E of the rules of procedure?
Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, it is.
Item E is members of the public representing neighborhood associations will state who they represent and under what authority with appropriate documentation, and they will be allowed 10 minutes after being duly sworn. Is there any member of a neighborhood association that was charged to give testimony to the Board of County Commissioners here with us today? Seeing none, Mr. Vito?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, it is appropriate to go ahead and move on to letter F.
Okay, F says the applicant will then be allowed to respond to the statements from the public which may be adverse to their position. This time shall come after all members of the public have had their opportunity to speak. Chairperson will allow up to 10 minutes for the applicant to respond. Mr. Yermuth or Mr. Tarleton, do you wish to?
Thank you, Commissioners. I just want to repeat a couple of things. The land is rural agricultural, period. It's not a residential neighborhood. As you know, we don't have any zoning in the county right now. And the overlays is where we're going with that. And in this overlay attempt, as Mr. Tarleton mentioned, that it was proposed that a project like this would be allowed. The visual impact of this is quite interesting in terms of this being an artistic community. Everyone likes some art and everyone doesn't. And whether or not you find a solar array is something that makes you feel comfortable about where we're going forward, and it looks like a blue pond off in the distance. It could look like an art installation that I've seen in various places, where you can see the Paseo in September. So one person's vision and version of what you're looking at could be another person's I hate it, another one I love it. I don't know how to legislate that. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Carlisle. I would just like to share the mic.
I would just like to show you two more pictures of the current UNM project, which would be the same array that we're installing there. This first picture shows the view from maybe just a few hundred feet north of the UNM. And what you can see on the right is where the collectors are sort of tilted down facing the west. You can see that this would be the view that they're talking about from Buggy Road. On the left-hand side of the sheet, you can see that all the land in between the collectors is all going to be naturally grassland. We're going to try to maintain what's there now. What you saw, the two of you that went today, what you saw, that's what you will see once the installation is done. The second picture that I wanted to show you was the picture that shows the visual effect of what is approved for what can be built on that land. It's not rural residential. A sustainable community, which includes schools like UNM to the left. So what you're looking at is a contrast between what you would see on the right of an array like what we're proposing, or on the left, which could be a school, filling stations, parking lots, auto repair, restaurants, etc., etc. Thank you.
Commissioner Blankenhorn.
Thank you. Mr. Tarleton, those pictures you showed of the solar array, they don't include that chain link barbed wire fence. You know, I agree with Mark that...
Well, do you see the chain link fence around that array?
No,
it's there. It's there.
Okay. So how high is this chain link fence?
The chain link fence would be 8 foot tall. The array itself would be up about 4.5 to 5 feet.
Right.
Once you're back from the array, you don't see the chain link fence there either. It's there. Once you're back from that chain link fence, 35, 40 feet, you don't see it anymore.
Mr. Chairman, no.
Commissioner Arvizo.
Mr. Tarleton, the area immediately north and east of where you plan to install the solar array is owned by yourself?
Not to the north.
We
own east, we own south. The Indian reservation is to the west.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, could I ask planning a question? Did we have a 6-foot limit on fences in our
land use regs, and do they need to get a variance?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner Donald, when we initially brought the land use regulations, when those were adopted in 2014, yes, there was a restriction of 6 feet, and anything above was prohibited, actually. When we did our amendment to the land use regulations in 2015, by right, up to 6 feet is allowed. Anything between 6 to 10 feet requires a permit, and anything in excess of 10 feet is prohibited under the existing land use regulations now.
So we would issue them a permit?
We would issue them a permit.
And how tall are the inverters?
Mr. Chairman and Commissioner Donald, we'll let the applicant address that question.
Okay, let me show you the... The inverters are going to stand maybe the same height as the collectors, about 4.5 to 5 feet tall. And they will be, there's two arrays. There's the north array and the south array. All the inverters and such forth that associated with the array will be between the two arrays on those concrete pads that we were talking about. They're deep, like 3 or 4 feet deep and long down the middle of the, between the two arrays. It's where the inverters and associated collectors will be located. Now, the transformer will be on the right side between the two arrays right there. That's where the output transformer will be, which is maybe a cube 4 feet by 4 feet by 4 feet tall.
Is it, Mr. Chairman, is it of your opinion that you need an 8-foot fence? Could you do a 6-foot fence?
We would have to check with our insurance regulator. I would say yes, it's possible. We were just trying to be safe. Right now, PNM is going against, putting up against somebody who got into their area and got electrocuted, and so they're being sued because, and they had a more than a 6-foot, they had more than a 10-foot fence around their substation, but somebody got in there to spray paint and got electrocuted. Now they're being sued. So it's a safety reason, and we'd have to check with our insurance carrier.
How does one get electrocuted?
Well, I don't know.
And Mr. Chairman, I just had one more question about the, in the packet, the National Register of Historic Places identified an area in the 58-acre tract, and just for my edification, I'd like to present this big map. If you could make an X where the, and it is, the site number is the most predominant, if you would take that, Mr. Santos, it's the most predominant National Register identified as 1LA158100. And I know it's the roads aren't running through there, but I just wanted to see where LA158100 is in relation to the roads you're going to build.
Are you referring to the archaeological report that was?
Yes.
See up there, that's a loop, it's called Milano Loop, that even that road is next to that site, but it doesn't infringe on the site.
All right, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Commissioner. There are no other questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, Commissioner O'Donnell, and Commissioners, specific to your question regarding fences under section 4.8.1, letter DD, ordinance 2015-2, the regulation of land use regulation that we're presently operating under, it states, fences not over six feet high are exempt from land use permit requirements and building permit requirements. Fences in excess of 6 feet, but not greater than 10 feet, shall require a cast iron approved building permit. And Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, Mr. Chairman, it would be very appropriate for you to go ahead and move on to the next portion of the rules of procedure.
Okay, well, H talks about meetings shall be conducted in an orderly and equitable manner. The chairperson will curtail repetitious testimony or repetitive questions or comments, but to the extent feasible, members of the public having interest in the matter will be allowed to speak. Chairperson may, at his discretion, increase the amount of time allotted a person in complex matters that require additional presentation time. Next, I, the chairperson, will enforce all rules and may appoint a sergeant at arms to enforce rules if necessary. J, after hearing from all parties, the chairperson will close the public testimony. Is that where we're at this time?
Mr. Chairman, we are.
Okay, then we will call the public testimony portion of this, these proceedings today closed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Moving on to the next item.
Okay, the Board of County Commissioners will then hear staff recommendations. Mr. Vito.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, obviously the applicant has requested 7 items that they believe that they provided a substantiation from not having to meet a certain requirement of the regulation. The one in particular that has raised questions, obviously, by the people speaking of concern or opposition is the burial of the transmission line. I don't think anybody else has raised any concern with the other items that the applicant has brought a substantiation on. While we as planning staff support the applicant's position, obviously you as the Board of County Commissioners can deny the applicant's request to put the power overhead and require that the applicant bury the transmission line if you so do so. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, moving along, I will respectfully refer you to page 6 of the Planning Department staff review, and I would like to refer to you to section 4.7.1, which is the development compatibility standards, before I gave you a recommendation. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, it is the Planning Department's determination, and I should indicate that I would refer to page 7. The planning director concurs with the response provided by the applicant and believes that the creation of the Tarleton HPV system is of low impact and sensitive to the traditional and historic uses in the neighborhood. The proposal is to develop approximately 7.7 acres of a 58 plus acre tract that is used for grazing purposes, of which the remaining 50 acres plus or minus will continue to be utilized for grazing purposes as indicated by the applicant. The project is located nearly 1,200 feet away from Valencia Road, the nearest public roadway. Further, the planning director concurs that the proposal will not create a substantial impact on the immediate neighborhood. As an unmanned facility, and as referenced by the applicant within the application, the project, if approved, is scheduled to become operational within 4 months of obtaining approval. There will only be a small impact during construction, and once constructed, there will only be periodic inspections of the site. Solar panels derive clean, pure energy from the sun, reduce the collective dependence on fossil fuel. It is too early to determine whether or not the project will assist in keeping electrical rates from increasing. However, the electricity generated from the PV system does keep the electrical rates from increasing. The project conceivably could provide a substantial benefit. Moving on to page 8. It is the planning director's determination that development is sensitive to design, scale, density, height, historical character, and orientation of the existing properties in the neighborhood. The project design and density will utilize 7.7 acres of the existing 58 plus acre tract where the project is designed to be located as far away as possible from the nearest public roadway. The height of the photovoltaic panels will be less than 7.5 feet, and the panels are designed to attract the sun or at the full 52-degree tilt, will only be visible during the morning hours facing the rising sun to the east, and during the evening hours facing the setting sun to the west. During the midday hours, the panels will be at a horizontal tilt. The historical character of the area, which is primarily grazing, will continue on the remaining 50-plus acres. The existing view sheds will have little or no impact as a result of the proposed development. And also, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, it should be noted that at nighttime, these panels basically sleep in a horizontal position, they lie flat. It is also the planning director's determination that the development being proposed is suitable to the land and neighborhood character. As referenced by the applicant, the panels will have a maximum height of 7.5 feet, and the chain link fence is proposed at a height of 8 feet. The panels and the chain link fencing will be non-reflective material. The only clearing of the existing native and wild grasses and sagebrush will be for the construction of the proposed Milano Loop and the Laundry Court and the 7.7-acre site. The orientation of the project in regards to existing properties in the neighborhood places the project in an area where developed structures are located. The nearest single-family residence, again, is located across the Valencia Road in excess of 1,200 feet, and there are no structures proposed within the project. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, testimony has been given this afternoon in regards to possibly requiring the applicant to shield or provide some type of barrier that would screen the project, and I would just like you to keep that in mind. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, next I would like to refer you to page 12. Should you choose to approve this application today, major development permit application number 1-2016, I propose the following findings of fact in your decision. Number one, the use is compatible as defined in section 4.7.1A, use of the land use regulations, which deals with compatibility with development sensitive to and with the existing traditional historic uses in the neighborhood. Number two, the use is compatible as defined in section 4.7.1 letter A, use of the land use regulations, which deals with compatibility, but the development will not have a substantial impact on the immediate neighborhood. Number three, the visual impact is compatible as defined in section 4.7.1B as a void. Visual impact of the land use regulations with the development is sensitive to the scale, density, building height, and orientation, basically the location, in reference to the existing properties in the neighborhood. Number four, the visual impact is compatible as defined in section 4.7.1B, visual impact and land use regulations, where the development being proposed is suitable to the land and the neighborhood character. Number five, as per section 4.8.1, letter A, roads. Because of the photovoltaic system site being an unmanned site and because no buildings are proposed, the proposed 16-foot wide driving surface of 6 inches of compacted base course for a linear distance of 2,400 feet is adequate for the construction of and for the proposed development. Number six, as per section 4.8.1c, water supply and quality, and as per section 4.8.1d, liquid waste disposal, and section 4.8.1, Americans with Disabilities Act, ADA. Because the photovoltaic system site is an unmanned facility where no buildings are proposed, the applicant shall not be required to meet current requirements of the New Mexico State Engineer, Office of the State Engineer, and the New Mexico Environment Department, NMED, or the provisions of the Americans with Disability Act, ADA. Number seven is for section 4.8.1F, stormwater control. Because the subject property and the location of the proposed access roadways are less than 3% in grade, the photovoltaic system site and roadways do not create a stormwater control issue. And lastly, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, number eight. The Board of County Commissioners have considered the site guidelines found in section 4.12.2 and evaluated the appropriateness of the proposed locations for solar projects. And the proposed project components has determined that major development 001-2016 complies with this section. Once again, let me be clear that the setbacks are 50 feet in the application and nothing less than 50 feet. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, recommendations. The Taos County Planning Director recommends to the Taos County Board of Commissioners that the Board of County Commissioners adopt the conditions major development permit 001-2016, application of Glenn Tarleton, managing partner of Venture One LLP based on the performance standards set forth in sections 4.7, 4.8, and 4.12 of Ordinance 2015-12, Taos County Land Use Regulations. And Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, we've identified for you 21 potential conditions that if you choose to approve this application, we would like to, you to append those conditions to this application, and we merely reference, make those, introduce those close to the record by reference. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners.
Mr. Chairman.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
How many poles are proposed on your property?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner O'Donnell, the applicant has specified that 3 poles would be proposed.
And then would, how many poles would Kit Carson put up on there?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner O'Donnell, Kit Carson is not proposing any additional poles. As the applicant testified, the within the PV system itself, the electrical cable will be buried underground. Outside of the chain link fence, it will come up to a point within the 50 plus remaining acres. But at that point, there will be a pole. At that point, it will, that would be the first pole. Would be a second pole. The other 2 poles will also be located on the Tarleton property, connecting to the 1 pole off of Valencia Road, or near Valencia Road. No additional poles will be inserted or being planned in this project as a result of Kit Carson having to place additional poles that would basically tie to the existing power pole system with the existing grid.
Would bury those 3 poles underground increase the cost significantly?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, I don't know the exact cost, and specifically the letter from Mr. Reyes has also indicated that it is beneficial to have the poles, the power line above ground that would be meant for servicing or repair or anything along those lines is required. I don't believe that the applicant has testified or given any monetary amount as to what the cost would be to bury it versus the overhead transmission. The concern of the applicant obviously has indicated that the rationale for having the power poles or the power poles in place of the electrical cable above ground is to reserve the opportunity to have future development at a later date, whereas if they go ahead and bury the power lines at this time, they may need to redig them or excavate them or relocate them for future development.
Well, Commissioner,
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much. And the size of these poles is just very typical Kit Carson Electric pole. It's nothing major, nothing taller than what, 40, 50 feet?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner, Propel, that's correct. It would be the existing standardized type of utility poles.
It's not the type of pole that you would see as you go up, say, for example, 518 or 538.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner, that is my understanding that it would not.
Mr. Chairman, could you just point me to that letter that Mr. Reyes wrote about the poles? What word is? What section of the...
That is found, Mr. Chairman, Commissioner O'Donnell, that is found within tab N, and as in Nora, of the orange binder that we provided you. And this email states, Kit Carson will build either overhead or underground based on the preference of the member requesting. However, the cooperative prefers overhead construction based on lower construction costs, lower operating costs, lower lifetime maintenance costs, lower replacement costs, and generally quicker restoration costs due to being able to locate faults on overhead systems as opposed to underground systems.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Commissioner Blake.
Thank you, Chairman. So all of the requirements of the LUR have been met by this application.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner Blankenhorn, it is my determination that they have.
Of course, you know, it's always, the rubber always hits the road with that compatibility standard, but I am persuaded by staff's arguments and the testimony given today that that this project would not have a substantial impact. There's no continuing traffic, there's no profile, no light, no noise. It's an important project in a lot of ways. There's a lot of benefits to it. So I'm comfortable with that. I'm also generally comfortable with the visual impact, but I do think it would be more suitable if those 3 poles were not placed on Valencia Road, especially given the fact
that Mr. Tarleton would like to bury that at some point during his subdivision.
They're not on Valencia Road.
Well, where they are. Where are they located? The additional poles.
On his property?
On Tarleton's property. But they still have a visual impact on the neighborhood. And so, in my opinion, it would be better to bury those from the start in order to make it more visually compatible and suitable. And I'm not persuaded, at least so far, I'm not persuaded by the argument that if you bury it now, somehow you're going to have to dig it up later. I mean, you can place it in the right place and then you won't have to dig it up and it would actually save you money in the long run. But, you know, I'm open to hearing.
Can we put that drawing back up that showed the locks and it shows actually where the poles were? There's a reason for that. But I'd like to interject to you guys if I did it here. I think that if the power poles, I think we all have the same feeling on that. I think there should be a time limit that those poles can be if it's truly this. But I want to show you something on this. If you zoom in to where the power poles are, and I'm assuming if you follow this line right there, it shows you the line. They're really close to the lot lines of lot. No, not that much. Please. No? Go back, zoom out a little bit. Okay. If you follow the contour around lot 9, 10, that went along that road, and then along 12, 13, 14, that's right up basically along the lot line. I don't understand why that couldn't be buried along those lines if this is going to be the subdivision application. Again, you're putting that stuff on the lot lines. I see that as a solution and it follows them almost perfectly. Now, I'm not in favor, if they have to start with the poles and if that argument holds, I still would like to see a time limit for those poles to come down. That's my opinion. And then the other thing on the fence, to go along with part of what Commissioner O'Donnell was getting with the fence, there's those little panels that slide in the fence to make it to where you're not seeing things, and they can be designed to match the surroundings, sage green and things like that. That would certainly hide this if people do feel that the effect would be strong. Has the applicant considered those panels in the chain link fence?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, as testified earlier, the Planning Commission, one of the Planning Commission members actually suggested to the applicant that he consider placing some of these slats within the chain link fence during the Planning Commission public hearing on July 13th. It was only a recommendation and the Planning Commission chose not to include that or incorporate that as a condition. So the applicant is aware of the discussions held that possibly could provide some slats within the chain link fence.
Commissioner, thank you, Chairman. That's where I was going myself.
Sorry, I guess I never looked at
that. Well, yeah, at the end, you're the chairman. But, in order to better meet the visual impact compatibility standard and make it more suitable and sensitive to, I agree with the chairman that there should be, those slats should be part of the requirements of the permit. And, you know, I still don't really see the advantage in putting up poles that you're going to take down later. The savings, I mean, obviously there is some per foot savings in that right now, but ultimately it would cost more. And in the interim, it would not serve the suitability of the visual impact to add three more poles to the neighborhood. And so I would also like to see that as a condition, those two additional conditions put on the permit.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I would like to know if we could add the green slab contingent upon what we're really going to see when the solar panels are built, because there are natural barriers in the area where a lot of areas you would not see the solar panels. And so I hate to put a condition on putting the entire fence be slatted with green. I'd like to place a condition afterwards out to where we're going to see those visual solar panels, because there is a natural barrier that you won't be able to see these panels in a lot of locations. So if there was a way to put a condition after everything's built, we take a look to see where there's visual impact, and at that point, because really the site has natural contours that you won't be able to see these panels.
Commissioner Romero.
Mr. Chairman, I feel very much the same way. The site visit was very beneficial for me. We looked at the distances of the nearest houses that are located in that area, approximate to where it's being proposed to be built. And there are a lot of natural contours, a lot of hills in that area that would probably cover a lot of the proposed project. I think that we also have to look at the fact that if there is a chain link fence that's going to be built around the perimeter for safety reasons, we need to look at what that height is going to be. And if you start to add slats to that chain link fence, it might even make it look worse.
Okay.
I don't even look, I've been enough of this Constantine wire or whatever it is that I have on top of it. Three strands of barbed wire on top of it.
I can't
get a fence on the bridge, but we can get
the UNM site. Do you have any ideas to how much acreage that is?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner Romero, unfortunately, I do not.
Okay. Does anyone know?
I think it was 3.55 acres from the research that I did, but.
So roughly twice the size of that.
Commissioner Blackman.
Hey, Chairman, I was wondering if staff had any recommendations on this burning or protective shielding. I'm certainly persuaded by the other commissioners that there may be portions of the fence that it's not necessary. I'd be happy to put a condition on the application that would leave it to the planning department's discretion. But I wondered if there are any options other than the slats that have been discussed.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner, first let me state that within the 21 recommendation that we provided to you, we did not, as plan staff, address any type of shielding or redevelopment. So let me put that aside. Let me indicate that I feel comfortable with Commissioner O'Donnell's recommendation and obviously that we should allow the applicant the opportunity to build a facility if you choose to move forward and approve this application. That we allow the applicant to build a facility, then we make a determination as to what areas may be create a visual impact, or those areas would be the areas that we would incorporate the slats possibly into the fencing. Because I wanted to pose a question to you, and Commissioner O'Donnell actually raised the point, but I want to raise the question to you. It's 2,400 lineal feet of chain link fencing. And so the question that I was going to ask of you, will you propose slat or slats within the entire 2,400 lineal feet of fencing? So it's hard at this particular point to make an exact determination as to what areas would or conceivably have a potential visual impact. We believe, as a planning firm, again, I stand firm that I would believe that it would have a significant impact, but in as a way possibly to shield the development, we certainly are receptive to that idea.
Thank you. And if not the slats, like what they use in building fields, it's called batter's eye, that mesh,
Mr. Chair, Commissioner, not in order to attach your question further, Have we spoken to the applicant? Because these concerns, especially from Mrs. McColl-Siak, have been raised prior to this hearing, and these emails have been forwarded to the applicant as well. During our site inspection yesterday prior to the public hearing, when I met with the applicant, we discussed the possibility of slats, and we also discussed the possibility of earthen berms. We also discussed the possibility of planting some trees to assist in screening the property. In terms of planting the trees, there's no water, so there's no guarantee that the trees would take. So that's one concern. In terms of providing some earthen berming, it'd be a significant amount of earth berming that we require. And absent of those, I don't know that we have any other options to utilize for potential screening.
Okay, Mr. Beal.
Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, moving along in terms of the rules of procedure, we can move on to the next item if you choose to do so, Mr. Chair.
Item L is the Board of County Commissioners will review all the documents, exhibits, testimonies, consider all applicable standards, weigh the evidence, and render a decision.
Chairman.
Commissioner Blankenhorn.
Having reviewed the packet, listened to testimony, and taking into account the evidence presented, I would like to make a motion to approve the application along with the 21 conditions set forth by the planning department. Add a further condition that the line underground, be placed underground in the area where the three poles are currently planned, and a final condition that appropriate screening be placed at the discretion of the planning department.
I'll go ahead and second that motion, Mr. Chair.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to take the 21, approve the application with the 21 conditions that were sent to us prior to, with the addition of the power line being underground and the possible changes in the fencing stuff as set forth by the planning department at the completion.
Mr. Chairman, I'm wondering if we could possibly add that if the planning department is going to require that fencing to be slatted, that it would planning department would make sure that the color of that slat would match as much as possible the natural surroundings.
And you know what may work better in that is that other suggestion that I had where they use it at parks is that screening.
A black material?
Black or green, or I think it's in numerous colors I've seen. It's called batter's eye. I don't know why they call that, but it's a baseball term. Blue colors.
I'll end on motion accordingly.
Adding,
Mr. Chairman.
And
friendly second, Mr. Chairman.
And the second.
And
Commissioner Thomas.
Still not sold on an 8-foot fence, and so I know it's safety, but I still would like to know if it would be your insurance company would permit a 6-foot with the barbed wire. I don't know. I mean,
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner Donald. That is a trip on it, and it's hard to put the applicant to make a decision and do a determination at this juncture. Obviously, as he's testified, without being able to consult with his insurance carrier, we recognize your concern of the fence being 8 feet and possibly that the height of the fencing may be creating an eyesore. We recognize that as well. For safety purposes, we as the planning department, as the planning director, would recommend that we keep the height of the fence at 8 feet.
Thank you. And I'll keep my motion as well.
And I had a second, and the motion was amended, and the second was amended as well. Commissioners, any further discussion?
Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Commissioner Blankenher?
Yes.
Chairman Farber?
Yes. Thank you all for your time, energy, and being here because you care about our community. Much appreciated on my part. Mr. Charlton, we trust that this will be a good project for the neighborhood, and we will hold you to your word.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Commissioners.
Anything else to come before the commission today? Item 6 is adjournment.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Second. Motion and second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much.